We are here today to celebrate the union between Carlos and Christina. Since the beginning of time, God knew that it was not good for man to be alone. It is why God put Adam into a deep sleep and took the rib from his side. He took the rib and created Eve, the perfect match, the perfect partner. God did not create Eve out of Adam's head to be over him or to dominate him. God did not create Eve out of Adam's foot to be trampled by him or to be underneath him, but from his side to be equal with him, from under his arm to be protected by him, and close to his heart to be loved by him. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
The family to family.
You may be seated. Ephesians 5:22-33 says, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands ought to also love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hates his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother, and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also is to love his own wife as himself. And the wife must see that she respects her husband." Paul writes to the church of Ephesus, and he wants to explain a wonderful relationship between those who believe in Christ and Christ himself. The union between our Savior and us. And Paul uses the example of marriage to teach this wonderful symbol. He first starts off and says, "Wives, be subject to your own husband," or "be submissive." Now, I know in our culture today, submission is not looked on as a good word or even a good practice. Many think that submission is slavery or some type of, it's backwards. Well, the Bible doesn't teach that. Christian submission is not backwards and it's not slavery. It's a willful desire to allow someone to lead. And Christina, Paul says to the church of Ephesus, as the wife is the example of the church, to be subject or submissive to Jesus Christ as you are to your husband. You are that picture of a willful following of his leadership. It doesn't mean that you don't have a mind of your own. It doesn't mean that you are his slave. In fact, I would encourage you to voice your opinion. Let him know where you stand and how you think and how you feel. Because then when Carlos is leading, he can lead better because he knows where you're at. And as he leads you both towards Christ, it'll be easy for you to follow his leadership. So Carlos, Paul writes to the Ephesians, and he gives a harder portion to you as a husband. Let's face it, us men, the last thing we do is give up our independence. The last thing we do is give up what we desire or our individuality. We usually do make the choice for ourselves. But you were to love Christina as Christ loves the church. And how did he love that church? He gave himself for it. You have to live and lead in her best interest. You do that no matter how she acts. Because let's face it, if our salvation was dependent, or if Christ going to the cross was dependent on our actions, he wouldn't have done it. He did it because he loved us. He went to the cross because he loved us. And you were to love her unsacrificially. You were to love her, sacrificing everything to make her life closer to Christ. To make her love better. You love her. You died for your independence today. You know, it's interesting. In tradition, usually the groom wears black. Not many people know why that is. It's the same reason why we wear black to a funeral. Today's your funeral, my friend. You died for your independence. You died for your wife, so that she can be holy and blameless before God. You were to present her spotless. Carlos and Christina have prepared their own vows for this. I'm going to ask Carlos to please say yours first.
Christina, I love you. I love you so much. I've never truly understood the definition of love until I met you, and I know now that it's more than a feeling or an emotion. It's so much more, because God placed you in my life to be your husband. He's blessed me with the meaning and the truth. My love for you is a lifelong compassionate and righteous dedication for your spiritual well-being. Together we will serve Christ. I love you, and I thank the Lord for the love that bound our hearts and lives together in spiritual fellowship of marriage. I take you as my wife before God, who brought us together to love and to cherish, even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. To lead you and to share all of life's experiences with you by following God through them. I promise to love you above all others and to value you in my life as a precious gift. I look forward to raising our family and building our relationship under the care and guidance of God. Through all of the uncertainties and trials of the present and future, I promise to be faithful to you and to love you.
Christina, would you please say your vows to Carlos?
Carlos, I vow to love the man that God intends and molds you to be. I also vow to fear the Lord and act in obedience to his will when we face challenges. I vow to cry out to the Lord when I'm failing you and to forgive you when you sin against me. I vow to work hard to help you and our family by the support and the honor of God's grace. I vow to happily walk to the call that God has for me and to help those in need. I vow to respect, honor, and to submit to you with a willing heart. I vow to be loyal to my commitment to God and to this marriage that I have with you. I vow to use my spiritual gifts and what I know in scripture to strengthen you and us as a couple. I vow to respect my body and to practice the fruit of the Holy Spirit and to remain honest and holy. I vow to not slander or gossip, to be sober-minded and faithful in all things. I vow to not be lazy, to grow spiritually, but to keep my eyes and ears open to any deception to better our love to God and snatch those from the fire from false teaching. I vow to love and to accept you when your sonship and the roles of a husband and father are tested. I vow to cherish what you can provide for me, and even when it is only your hand that you can offer. I vow to be one with you and to strengthen our marriage, to be wise, to not turn to the world or to those in the world for advice and for friendship, for the protection of our marriage and faith. I vow to not cease to study the word and to stand for the faith and to train our children in the direction of the Lord, to hold fast and to allow God to use us as his godly purpose till Jesus returns. I vow to respect you and to help you strengthen your strengths, gifts and talents, and your own weaknesses, to always look for your best interest. I vow to allow God to work through my sins and bad behaviors to persevere for the better. I vow to take care of you the way God sees precious in a wife. I vow to live as a Christian woman so that I am judged as a Christian, that to be judged lukewarm. I vow to tell the truth and to not hold onto lies or secrets, but to act in love to secure your confidence and to satisfy you in what I have and what I work for and what I hope for in God. I am so honored to stand before a man that God has blessed me with. You are so incredible. I love you, Carlos.
To be honest, I thought it was going to be a lot longer. Now that you have said your vows, Carlos and Christina, what symbols do you have to give and make your commitment to each other? The ring is a symbol, and it's the perfect symbol. The ring is two metals coming together to make one ring. It has no beginning and it has no end. Which the commitment you make to each other today symbolizes. Wear these rings every day. Every day you look at your finger and you remember the commitment and the vow you made today. Such blessings. Dear Father, thank you so much for Carlos and Christina and their commitment to each other. Lord, I ask that these rings would be forever a symbol, a reminder of them, of the vows they make to each other, the commitment they make to each other. And Lord, when Satan comes and tries to distract them, that this ring would be a symbol that brings them back into focus to your will for their lives. Lord, we ask that you bless these rings, that you would bless their marriage, and that you would always be the center, and that you would help them to grow continuously in you and for each other. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Carlos, will you take Christina's ring and place it on her left ring here and repeat after me? I, Carlos, give you this ring to be my wife. To have and to hold. In sickness and in health. For rich or for poor. As long as I live. Christina, would you take this ring and place it upon Carlos's left hand? I, Christina, give you this ring to be my husband, to have and to hold, in sickness and in health, for rich or for poor, as long as I live. Christina and Carlos have picked uniting a stand to symbolize their commitment. Unity stand is a newer idea of showing commitment. As you look at the stand, you saw there was a white stand on the bottom, which signifies Christ. That your marriage is built upon Christ. And I always find it interesting as the couples try to, you get to see how they work together as they pour. And I love watching you two work together because you laugh. You don't try to outdo one another. You're both patient with each other. This is a perfect picture of what your marriage is going to be like. And as I've got to get to know you two, this is exactly how I know your marriage is going to be. And as you shook it to get every ounce out of it, I know that's what you're going to do as a husband. You're going to give every ounce of yourself to Christina. And I know she did the same thing. In fact, you put your finger in there, didn't you? You never lose that, folks. You never lose it. It's a perfect picture. And as this sits in your home for the rest of your life, may it always remind you of how the two have become one flesh. There's no greater picture or symbol in the church that demonstrates Christ's love in communion. And now that you've given your vows and you've promised with your rings, we're going to take communion for the first time as a married couple. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ died for our sins. At the time when the Bible was written, it was customary for a man, when he entered into the engagement process, that he would go to his father's home and he would start to build on top of his father's home the home that he would have his family in. When the project was done, he would come and make the journey to get his wife, just as Christ did. He left, he came, and he entered an engagement process. He died on the cross. That was his commitment to us. And when he died, he left. And he is building us a place. John 14:3 says, I go therefore to prepare a place for you. And I will come again and receive you into myself, that where I am, you will be also. To bring the possibility of us to have a relationship, he had to die on the cross for our sins. The cup represents the blood. The bread represents the body. The body which was broken for our sins. The blood which was shed to cover our sins. The body which was given for payment. The blood which brought the new covenant of grace, so that all who would believe would have eternal life. And this morning, we remember, as we take communion, that promise that he gives. And if you folks would join us, you should have gotten a communion cup and bread. The bread is in the bottom cup, the juice is in the top cup. And we're going to take communion because we believe and we remember the sacrifice. And for you, Carlos, this is more significant. Every time you think of Christ dying, you have to remind yourself you are to die. Every time you take the cup, as he gave a new covenant and promise, you must give that same covenant promise to your wife. The night which he was betrayed, he took the cup of the bread and he broke it. He said, this is my body which is broken for you. My body which is given freely. My body which I give to pay for your sin. So that I can have a relationship with you. He took it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. And he says, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. He took the cup. He said, this is my blood that is shed for you. Though your sins would be as scarlet, my blood will make you as white as snow. It's interesting, Christina, you wear a white dress, as every bride wears a white dress. You are presenting yourself as a pure bride to your groom. And Jesus Christ's blood does that for us. His blood washes away our sin, covers our sin, so that when we are presented to him before the Father, we are as white as snow. He took the cup and he said, this is my new covenant. As often as you do this in remembrance. I'm going to give you one last charge. That you would always remember to love each other. Every day that you wake up, you make a conscious choice to spend the rest of your life with each other. That's what love is, folks. Love is not an emotion, it's not a feeling. It's not the spicy burrito. The love that God commands us to have is the love that we choose every day to be together. Don't let Satan come in and change your mind on that. Invest in each other's life. Just as Jesus Christ invested in us, invest in each other. As my mentor always told me, the secret to success is investing in the lives of people and pointing to Jesus Christ. I not only found that to be the success in ministry, but I also found it to be the success in my marriage and in my raising of my sons. And in every relationship that I have, The secret to being successful is not wealth, not a big home, not a fancy car. It's investing in each other and pointing each other to Jesus Christ. By the power given to me by the state of Texas, by the authority of Jesus Christ and the Park Hills Christian Church, I pronounce you husband and wife. Carlos, you may kiss your bride. Let me be the first to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Carlos Quintana.
Have a wonderful day, folks.